Welcome to Big Blend Radio with your hosts, Lisa and Nancy, editors of BigBlendMagazine.com.
Hey, everybody on Big Blend Radio today. We are calling all wannabe hobbits because travel writer Debbie Stone is back to share her adventures that she went to Hobbitland, basically. She went on the set of, the Hobbit and the Lord of the Rings. She actually got to explore that in Northern New Zealand, and you can see her story in the spring issue of Big Blend Radio and TV Magazine that really runs from April through May, and it's up there right now on blendradioandtv.com. So I look at her photos, and I'm like, this is a giant garden of Hobbitland, and I want to go live in Hobbitland.
Me too.
That's what I'm calling it, Hobbiton, but it's Hobbitland to me. Debbie is a regular Big Blend Radio contributor and article contributor as well in our different magazines, Big Blend Radio and TV Magazine and Parks and Travel Magazine. You can see her on the websites and in our expert department under blendradioandtv.com and nationalparktraveling.com. And we call her Fire Monkey. So Fire Monkey went hobbiting. How are you, Fire Monkey?
Yes, I went hobbiting, and it was, and I returned. But I mean, it's sadly that I returned. Sadly, because I really, really felt at home at this place. Hobbiton was my kind of place because I'm a very, as I said, height challenged or petite or short, as you might say it, woman. And this place, Hobbiton, was just ideal for people of my size, really. It was just, and not only that, it was just so, such a beautiful place. I really wanted to stay. It was just, I said to myself, this has got to be my home.
Oh, see, now I would like to have my Amazon woman home.
No, she's like a fire monkey hobbit.
Yeah. I know. Did you feel like you could fly around? Like,
pardon me?
Did you feel like you wanted to fly around everywhere?
Like, not fly. It's just, you know, it's just these little hobbit holes were like the perfect size for me. And I thought, gosh, you know, this is just, I don't have to, you know, strain to reach something. I don't have to need step stools. I don't have to, you know, be ducking under people. And it was just, this was just like perfect for me. I really felt, you know, like everything was just like made for me kind of thing. Mm,
that's
so
cool.
Somebody built the Hobbit Hotel, you would live in it.
Or at least visit and drink ginger beer and drink ginger beer. Did you
yes.
try it? Did they have the ginger beer?
Oh.
This is important.
Of course. Yes.
Mm. Oh, wow.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. They make their own beer there. And yeah, you get to imbibe. You had a nice little drink after the end of your tour at the Green Dragon Inn. And yeah, everything is their cider and the beer is specially brewed for Hobbiton. You could only get it at Hobbiton. So
wow.
You have to go there to actually be able to try it. But yeah, it's this, you know, I've always been enamored. I mean, I loved the books. I loved all the Lord of the Rings series. And all Tolkien's and The Hobbit, and I remember reading them when I was younger, and just you know, just the fact that they have he was just crazy amazing in terms of the imagination that he had in creating these worlds, this Middle Earth, and this just, you know, incredible characters and this, you know, good versus evil fantasy. And when the movies came out, you know, they took it to another level because they just captured what your visions of what you imagined from, you know, reading the books. And it was like, oh my gosh. So then when I found out I was going to go to New Zealand, I was like, well, this is the land of the Lord of the Rings. I mean, Peter Jackson, the director, you know, that's where they were filmed those movies. And I had heard about this place called Hobbiton because it's the only living movie set in the world.
Wow.
And I thought, I have got to go there. It's got to be put on my list.
For
and
sure.
So yeah, no, it proved, you know, I had high expectations and they exceeded it totally.
What, when it's called a living movie set, is it because it's on someone's land that actually is farming and doing stuff? Or is it, can people, you know, because you can eat and drink on the set, or is it, can I want to stay in one of those little places?
Because mushrooms are growing.
Yes, I was going to say, because it's a living set, which means that it's everything there is living in terms of, you know, all the plants you see, all the fruits and vegetables that you see are growing are all alive. They're real.
So it is a garden. It's a giant garden.
It is a garden, yes. And they employ all these, you know, people who work in the gardens and the landscape. And we saw a bunch of them, and they're, you know, they're doing all the landscaping. And so it is, I think that is what it is. It's a living movie set, as opposed to just a movie set that just has props and structures up and nothing's alive, so to speak.
And plastic plants.
Right, right.
Wow.
Exactly.
And so could you go in?
King Kong. King Kong has the most plastic plants of all.
Oh my gosh, here we go. Could you go in the little, because the little round doors and everything's so round. I love it. You know, could you open those or like?
You know, they are, okay, so first of all, there are about 44 of them, and they're like basically a facade, which means that if you would open them, it's just like a little tiny space in between, in back of them. Mm-hmm. And so we were allowed to go into one, and there really was like, there's like nothing in there. It's just like a little kind of dead space, so to speak. So they are mostly for the facades, because, you know, whatever set was done for the movie that was inside a Hobbit home was done, of course, on another set design kind of thing. So this was basically, you know, for the village site where you saw, you know, the Hobbits moving around and, you know, outside and you know, going towards their Hobbit holes and whatnot. So, so it's basically the facades, and it's on this rolling hill, and it's on a very, you know, it is still a working sheep farm. It's got about 12 acres on that is the set. The sheep farm is many, many more thousand acres, and you can see the sheep farm all over the place, but the set itself is a portion of that, and it's still a working farm. You know, it's owned by the Alexander family, who've been farming on it for quite a while, and the story that goes with that is pretty funny, because the director was up in a helicopter, Peter Jackson, and he was looking from an aerial viewpoint of where he could create Middle Earth, so to speak, and where he could put this village for the Hobbits, and he saw this incredible place, which he thought would be perfect for the Shire, which was the Hobbits' place where they lived, and he saw it, and it was perfect because it was green, it was rolling hills, it was pastures. And it was untouched, and that was a big thing because there were no power lines and there weren't any buildings, there were no, you know, roads, and it meant that he could create this and he wouldn't have to worry about all that other stuff marring it or causing obstructions or whatever. So he landed his helicopter down, and then he went to find where the owner lived and knocked on the door, and the owner was watching his rugby and was not very happy about being interrupted, especially by some stranger, and he told him to go away. And
you know, he didn't say it that way. Right.
Yeah. Well, I think he said it. Yeah, in other terms. But anyway, Jackson persisted and later came back, and the owner agreed, and they created this great Shire, this place. And it took about a couple of years, and I think even the New Zealand Army was involved, and they spent a couple of months filming for the Lord of the Rings trilogy. And then they, like, the stuff that they made was made from like stuff that wasn't permanent materials, you know what I mean? It was like untreated and non-permanent. And so when he finished, most of those structures were torn down, but they had like curious tourists and people that heard about this and who wanted to go and see it. And they would come, but they'd have to use their imagination because most of it was, you know, stripped down to nothing. But flash forward, you know, several years later, 2009, he comes back because he wants to film the Hobbit trilogy. And this time the Alexander family said, yes, but you need to construct things out of permanent materials because we want to give visitors more of a complete rendition of what this place looks like.
Very cool. And so this is not far from Auckland, New Zealand, right?
No, it's you know, like within a couple hours, so to speak.
Oh, wow.
And we rented a car for the North Island. And so we drove all around. And let me tell you, when you know, driving on the left side of the road takes a little bit of practice, especially because they have all these roundabouts and everything. So anytime that we were driving, it was like one of us would be saying, left, left, you know, it was like.
Oh, my gosh. I can imagine. It's like, you're like, here we come, we're the tourists, you know. I
totally understand.
I know, they should give us, you know, when we travel overseas and we're on the other side, they should give us the learning permit car with the big L. on
believe
there.
Me, I can't believe it. You know, it's like, it's just like, wow. It's like, you know, to trust somebody who's, you know, whole reference point is not on the left side when it comes to that. You know, I mean, you're sitting in the car in a different place. And I'd, you know, if I was a passenger, I kept going into the driver's side and vice versa, you know, and it was just... It was just, you know, it's crazy. And then, you know, crossing streets, you have to look the other way, you know.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of like, oh, my God, you know, you just, I mean, my husband and I were both like looking, okay, right, left, right, right, left, right.
Yeah, and it was like,
That is so funny.
I've always wondered why it's different. Like, why is the British side looking this way and the American side's looking that way? I mean.
It's crazy.
It's like, okay, we got away from the British, so we're going to do everything different. So
I mean, our language, our, you know, everything, our accent, many of our words are, it's still English, but it's different English, you know? And, you know, us, you know, you know, New Zealand, there's a lot of the British influence in everything, of
Absolutely.
Course, you know? Yeah.
But it's funny.
When we were in Florence, Nancy, with Eva, our travel writer friend, Eva, we were, it's our hometown, it was in Colorado in the last year, and we were, you know, her car looked similar to mine, and she was driving around, and we, like, decided to do this extra video project, and blah, 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 she's taking us around, and I run out of the car, I'm taking these photos of the railroad depot, and come running back, and I'm so used to running in and out of my car to take photos. And I jumped in the car and almost jumped on her lap. If there wasn't a steering wheel, and I scared the living heck out of her because she's sitting, she was looking at something on her map or something on her phone, like totally didn't expect the door out of nowhere to open up. And he's just going to sit on your lap, you know? And it's just, you know, that, and it's that same feeling of being on the other side of the road. It's funny.
Yeah.
It is funny.
It is a weird feeling. And then, you know, after being gone for a month and doing this, we come back and then it's like, of course, then you're reorienting yourself and I'm in the car and I'm going, holy crap. You know, it's like, mm-hmm. I'm like, okay, I've got to get back. Okay. No. You know, it's like kind of like erase the past month and my reference point of being left. Now I'm back to being right. And it's like, of course it doesn't take that much time, but it's a weird feeling.
And then you go to Hobbiton, I should say. And everyone, you can go to HobbitonTours.com. So it's HobbitonTours.com to check it out. And you can also see the article, as I was saying, Debbie's article up on BlendRadioAndTV.com and in the spring issue of Big Blend Radio and TV magazine, which is a real focus on gardens because it's spring and we need to go to gardens. And this is definitely unique. It's just near Auckland. But you said it's the village of Mata Mata. I just want to say it, Mata Mata.
Yeah, it's Mata Mata. It's outside the village of Mata Mata. And so, you know, the village is like the little town that's the closest town to this place. But this place is out, you know, it's in the countryside. And, you know, I think people should, you know, make that a little extra effort. And I said in my story, and I think it's very true, that even if you're not a fan of Tolkien's works or Jackson's films in this respect, you will still, I think, really enjoy it because a lot of the people that were in the tour that I was in, I mean, they asked how many people, you know, saw the movies or read the books. And there were a number of people who had not done either. And they, you know, they were there either because they were with somebody who wanted to or just because they were curious and they'd heard about it and thought as long as they were in the country, they were going to go see it. And everybody who went there, you know, people were just like, it was like this, charming, you know, this is just amazing and beautiful in like an English country garden kind of thing. And the detail was intense, just, you know, intricacies are incredible and little gardens and little tools and laundry that's hobbit sized clothing and, you know, just little mailboxes and Middle Earth cursive, you know, the writing. And it's just, you just kind of, you go to yourself, this is just too precious, you know,
it's a
too precious.
Big dollhouse. It's like a dollhouse community.
Yes.
Wow.
That's
and
really
so then
funny.
I thought it was interesting is how they got to make moss grow through vinegar and yogurt on wood. So it would actually create like a little yeast and make the moss grow.
And make the moss grow, which is, I think, really, really a cool. I mean, it's they had all sorts of techniques. You know, we learned a little about the movie magic and things. And you know, they had this one tree that they had originally had. It was a real tree, and that's probably the only fake thing on that living quote unquote movie set. But it was a tree that was actually transported. But they also then created these artificial leaves and individually wired each one onto the tree. And then later they got an artificial one. But you look, and you know, our guide said, okay, look around you, look all over the place. Does anything look like it's not real? And really, I could not tell. You know?
Wow.
And it was just, it was just cool. One of those things, you know, that you really, that just kind of blended itself in there. You know,
is that the one that you think was that big, beautiful oak?
Yes, it's the party tree. It was used for the party tree, I believe. Bilbo's birthday? I can't remember who it was. His birthday. They used it for the party, I think it was. But the place that Bilbo and Frodo Baggins, the two hobbits that played a major part in The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings, their house is called Bag End, and it's like more of a little bit bigger of a hobbit hole that's, you know, you kind of know that it's a little bit more special. But outside there's like this bench, and on it is like, you know, this book and this pipe, and you know that Gandalf the wizard was there because he was sitting there. And, you know, they have these like amazing detailed touches, and it's just, you know, it's just, to me, it's a remarkable way to, you know, put yourself into that spot.
And you want to go and watch it again, you know?
Yes.
When you do that kind of thing, you want to go and see it before, see it after, have that complete thing of, you know. And I think it's interesting with things like this, because you start to understand how films were made. And you have, like, you know, it's a lot of places we travel to. I mean, look at where we were up in Santa Fe, where, you know, your area in New Mexico is such a movie hub. I mean, Gallup, look at Gallup and that whole area. Yep. And we were just talking about Monument Valley with you. And you start to wonder, how did they do this? How did they, is that painted? Is that not? What's real? What's not? And, you know, when you're watching it, you're just mesmerized when it's really good. And then afterwards, you're like, well, dude, how did they do that? You know?
Yeah.
So that's really cool.
And you're blown away by, you know, how they make that magic. I think it's just because it's so believable and everything, you know, looks real. But in this case, this is a real place with growing things, and it has to be taken care of. And so in order to continue to be this way. And so to me, that's really, I don't know, it's quite special.
I love that.
Just a movie set,
that's,
you know.
That's cool.
It's very magical. Yeah. And I play your song for the day. You know, we love to play music. This one is called Visa från Utenmyra. It is from Sweden. It is a Swedish folk song. It's about the forest. And I just, to me, it's very magical. And I feel like hobbits and fairies and all kinds of things can pop up and do what they
want. Oh, I thought you were gonna do Randy Newman's Short People or whatever.
No, I know. I know. That came to my mind too. And I do have interesting songs, but I wanted to keep the magic of the Hobbit land. Hobbiton.
Right.
I've got to say HobbitonTours.com, everyone. Again, Debbie, you'll see her up on nationalparktraveling.com, blendradioandtv.com, contributor to both magazines and here on Big Blend Radio. So we want to thank you, Debbie, for sharing your Hobbiton adventures in, you know, the little land. It's
cute. You're welcome.
It's
such a pleasure.
It's just so cute. And everyone, keep up with us here on Big Blend Radio. We air Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Sundays, except for holidays, because at that point we expect you to be out having a good time and traveling and visiting something magical like Hobbiton. So here it is. This is from John Magnusson. And it's off of his latest album. It's an instrumental album. This Is All It Takes is what it's called. You can hear his interview up on blendradioandtv.com. But this is a Swedish folk song. And I can't pronounce it because I'm not Swedish, but I try. And it's Visa från Utenmyra or Utenmyra, whichever you want. So here it is. Get your visa packed.